Oh no, there's a failing test. Let's see how the IntelliJ IDEA debugger can help us find and fix the bug. And we'll learn some neat tricks about the debugger in the process. Currently, this test fails because the expected average does not match the result of the method getAverageScore. Let's set a breakpoint in this method to see what happens. When we run the test in debug mode, execution will stop when it hits the breakpoint, so we can look at the state of our application. We see inline debugging information in the editor. Here, we see that the list of test scores has size 3. We can even click in the editor to expand this list to see the details of the values in this list. We also see that test scores is empty evaluates to false, and therefore, the return statement inside that if statement is unreachable and grayed out. In the debug tool window, we see the call stack, or the methods that were called, on the left. We can also see information about objects and variables, like the student and their test scores in this example. Now we can step through the code to see what happens using different step actions. Use step over, F8, to step over a line and go to the next line. Notice that the values shown in line are updated and we can see the individual scores. We can use step into, F7, to step into a method that is called on a line. In this example, we can step into getTestScore, which isn't very interesting. We can continue stepping to return to the call site once we exit the method, or use step out, shift F8, to return directly. Once all the scores have been added, we see that the total score is 25. And here we see the problem with our logic. We forgot to divide by the number of test scores. To make sure our intended fix is correct, we can use evaluate expression. If we evaluate total score, we get 25, as we can already see in the debugger. But if we evaluate total score divided by test scores.size, we get 8.333, which is the expected average. Notice that we can evaluate expressions that aren't currently part of our code. Let's apply our fix and rerun the test. We no longer need this breakpoint, so let's remove it and click Resume Program. We see that the test has passed. This is clearly a simplified example, but you can see how the debugger is useful to find and fix bugs in the logic of your code. We can even evaluate expressions to try our potential fixes. This method to calculate the average test score is part of a small application that reads test scores from a CSV file, calculates the average score per student, and prints the result to the console. Now that we've fixed our failing test, let's see if our application works correctly. Again, there seems to be a problem. Let's use the debugger to find out what's wrong. Note that we can create a breakpoint right from the console. This opens the breakpoints dialog, where an exception breakpoint has been added for the date-time parse exception. Now when we run our application in debug mode, it will stop when and where this exception is thrown, so we can figure out what caused it. As we can see, the value 8.7 cannot be parsed as a date time, which makes sense. But where does this value come from? To find out, we can go back in the call stack. We can use reset frame to go back to the previous frame. Let's do so until we get to the point in our code where we try to parse this value into a date. Note that there are limitations to using reset frame. It only resets local variables, not static and instance variables. It also won't undo any side effects of your application, like console output. None of that is relevant in the current example, but you should be aware when you use reset frame in the future. Now we see that 8.7 is actually a test score, as you might have guessed. When we view the data for the parts of the line, we see that the date is in the next part. We're parsing the same part of the line twice. That looks like a copy-paste error. We've all been there. We should be parsing the part of the line that contains the date. Let's fix that. Note that we could have also gone directly to this line in the code from the console, but I wanted to show you how to set a breakpoint for an exception in case you ever need it. In fact, while we're here, let's make sure that we're parsing all the parts of the lines correctly. As we can see in the code just above, our CSV file contains a header. Let's print this header to the console to make sure we parse each part of the line to the correct field. We could add a system out print line to our code to print the header, but we don't want to risk print statements ending up in production. Fortunately, there's a better way to do so. Let's create a non-suspending breakpoint, meaning that execution will not stop on this breakpoint, and set it to log the line to the console when the breakpoint is hit. Now the header is printed to the console, but so are all the other lines from the file. That's not what we need. Oh, the breakpoint is on the wrong line. It should be on the next line. We could set a new breakpoint, but then we have to redo all the configuration. Instead, we can drag and drop the existing breakpoint to the next line. Now, when we run the application in debug mode, only the header is printed to the console, along with the output of our program, of course. It looks like our fields correspond correctly to the headers of the file. Let's run our application again to see if everything is now as it should be. The application runs without errors, but it looks like student Olivia has a negative average test score. That can't be right. Let's see what's going on. We'll set a breakpoint in the code where we add test scores to the student. When we run our application in debug mode, execution will stop every time this breakpoint is hit. We can click the Resume Program button, either in the debug tool window or in line in the editor, to get to the next test score. See how the values change? It's going to stop for every test score in this file, so that might take a while. There must be a better way. Of course there is. We can use a conditional breakpoint. Since we don't need execution to suspend until we process Olivia's test scores, we can set condition to student name equals Olivia Garcia. Now when we resume, we get to her test scores and see that the test score is negative. To see if that's the case for all her test scores, let's add a watch to the field test score. This makes it easier to explicitly watch the value of a field. When we click Resume Program, we see that all her scores are negative. That would explain her negative average. This looks like a problem with the input data. Let's open the CSV file to make sure Olivia's scores are no longer negative. In this example, we can fix our input data ourselves. If you're dealing with user input that you can't change, consider adding validation to the code, for example, that test scores cannot be negative. Let's run our application one more time to see that everything is in order. Yes, that looks more like it. In this video, we've seen how to use the debugger to find and fix several types of bugs, from problems with the logic in the code, to reasons that exceptions are thrown, and finding problems with input data. Is there anything else you'd like to learn about the debugger? Please tell us in the comments. And if you want to see more videos like this, please like and subscribe. Thanks!